Hey guys, this is Anthony Morganti. I am MrPhotographer.com. In this video, I'm going to show you my processing workflow in Luminar 3 so you could take an unprocessed image such as this and come up with something like this. About a month ago, a photographer emailed me asking me if I could demonstrate my processing workflow in Luminar 3. They were saying that there's just so many filters in Luminar 3, they really don't know where to start and where to go with their processing. And I said, sure, I'd be glad to do a video. I am sorry that it's taking me almost a month to do the video, but here we are. So in this video, I'm going to demonstrate my processing workflow. I hope I don't disappoint you, because typically I don't process my images as heavily as many people think I do, so I don't use that many different filters, but I'm glad to share with you what I do in Luminar 3. What I suggest you do is not copy me exactly. Take a little bit of what I do, maybe a little bit of what someone else does, and a little bit of what you like to do, and kind of blend it all together to come up with something that's exclusively you. Now, I am doing something different for any of my videos where I show one of my images. In the description below the video, you're going to find all the camera and exposure info for that image. So in the description below this video, you'll see what camera and lens I used, what modes my camera was in, where I focused, what my f-stop and shutter speed were, and things like that. You'll find that all in the description below this video. All right. What I usually do, what I start with, and what I always do first is I crop the image. I just like to straighten and crop the image right at the top and then go from there. Now, in the case of this image, I really don't think it needs any cropping and it seems to be very straight, but I would go up to the crop tool and I would look and then crop it from here. Now, I do have the sculpture right at a point of intersection, so that's good. Pretty much satisfied with what I did in camera for this image. So I really don't need to crop, but that's what I would do first. The next thing I would do is I would just see that if I have a preset or a look, if you prefer, that fits with the scene. I don't like processing images. I really don't like sitting behind the computer processing. So if I have a preset, I'll just go and see if I have something that I like and click on it. And it would save me a lot of time. Now, I know that this doesn't help you at all, so I'm not going to do this for this image. Real quick though, I did click on one of the presets that I do sell, Morganti's Luminar Preset Pack. They're also called Looks. In the description below the video, you'll get a code. You get 50 presets for $15, but with that code, you could have the presets for 10 bucks. So I'm going to escape out of this and undo it, and I'm going to close down the film strip along the bottom so we have more room to work with. So I crop the image. I see if I have a preset or look that fits that image. And if I don't, then I'll actually, from this point on, do some real processing to the image. So I'm going to go over to the right-hand side, click on Add Filter, and I'll start out with the Raw Develop filter because this is a raw file. If you don't have a raw file, if you're working on a JPEG or a TIFF or something, you'll have, instead of the raw develop, you'll just have the develop filter. And I do start right at the top and I go left to right across the tabs. I'll start with the adjust tab and I will look at the profiles first. I'll just hover over each of the profiles and see if there's a profile that I think makes the image look more compelling than the existing profile or the Luminar default profile. And as I go over them, I like Camera Vivid. And I think that's the one I'll go with. So I'll just go with Camera Vivid and click on that. After I do that, I adjust the white balance. And I rarely use the dropdown. I know a lot of photographers exclusively use the dropdown, but I rarely do. I mean, if you want, you could like go to Cloudy to warm it up. You could go to Tungsten to cool it down. I rarely ever use that dropdown. I'll either come in and manually adjust the sliders, temperature and tint, or more often, I'll use the eyedropper. And what I'll do is I'll click on the eyedropper tool to activate it. Then I look for something that should be neutral in the image. That's like no color in it. And in the real scene, there was no color there, and hopefully middle gray. So in this case, I'll just click on like a gray cloud. And you could see it gives a white balance, or a specific type of white balance. In this case, it warmed it up. If I don't like it, I'll click on the eyedropper again and click on a different spot. And I'll just keep doing that until I get a white balance that I feel correctly represents the scene as I saw it that morning. So this actually still maybe a little bit too. It's a little better. Yeah, it was, it was a little bit warm in the warm areas, but a little bit cool throughout. So I like that setting right there. So we did the white balance. Next then, because I did that, I really don't have to adjust the temperature and tint sliders. I'll go to exposure. Is it exposed properly? In this case, I think it is, so I'm not going to move that slider. Contrast. I almost never use the contrast slider, and I'll explain what I do later and why I do what I do later. So I will not use the contrast slider, but I will adjust highlights and shadows with the two sliders. I'll bring highlights down usually because I want to make sure that I'm seeing detail in the highlights. So I'll just pull highlights down and look at the brightest parts of the image to make sure there's detail there. Similarly, for shadows, at this point in my processing, I want to see detail in the darker parts as well. So I'll take shadows and I'll move that to the right to open up those shadows so that I'm seeing some detail in those darkest parts of the image. In this case, I have to move shadows considerably higher. Next, I'll do a white or black point, and a white and black point, and I do it a very specific way. I'll hold the Alt or Option key in. Alt if you have a PC, Option if you have a Mac, click on the whites slider, and you'll notice the screen turns totally black. I'll move this to the right until I see some color bleeding through. And you can see some greens and reds bleeding through down here. That means I'm starting to clip those channels, those color channels. We have red, green, and blue color channels. And when you see that color bleed through, you're clipping that channel. If you see white come through, that means at that point you're clipping all three channels. When you're clipping a channel, that means it's so bright, there's not going to be any detail in that area at all. I prefer to adjust my white point so my highlights have detail. So I will back this off until all that color disappears. Now, this isn't like a way everyone needs to do this. This is purely subjective. This is the way I like to adjust the white point. Similarly, for the black point, I'll again hold in the Alt or Option key, click on the black slider. This time the screen turns white. I'll pull the blacks down and you'll see that I'm starting to clip greens and reds and coming through. Where you see black, that means I'm clipping all three channels. Now, I like to clip the blacks a little bit. I like to have some absolute black in my image. So I will adjust this so that some of the color is bleeding through and then take a look. I feel that this gives my image more tonal depth. So when I have something in the image that's absolute black and stuff that is nearly absolute white, I think that gives me a lot of tonal depth. So I could come in and readjust that a little, back it off just a little. And I think that looks pretty good. Now, typically, I don't often do much with clarity. I might just add a little bit. In this case, I'm not going to add any because I think structure might work better. So I'm going to use a filter later on to add a little structure. One thing you have to be careful of when adjusting an image with Luminar 3, because there's so many filters and so many of the filters do similar things, if you start piling on, you're going to overdo it. So it's very easy to overdo it. If I bring clarity up to, let's say, 30, and then I add a microstructure filter, let's say, later, it might overdo it. So I'm going to keep structure all the way, or clarity, I'm sorry, all the way down. Then I'm going to move to the next tab. I'm going to make sure that lens distortion, chromatic aberration, and defringe are checked so that we're adding lens corrections to the image. Then I'm going to go to the transform tab. Now, really, in this image, I don't need it, but if I had a building or in the scene, or if I had something that should be perfectly vertical and something perfectly horizontal, some perfectly square corners, and I got to make sure those are square, I would come to the transform tab and adjust some of those sliders, but I don't need to. So I'm done with the raw develop filter. I may come back and readjust things, but right now I'm done. At this point, what I'd like to do is remove noise. So I'm going to go to Add Filter and go to Denoise. It's under Issue Fixers. The reason why I like to remove noise early in my workflow, because it's just easier to remove the noise earlier in your workflow. If you start adding a bunch of filters and you do a lot of different structure adjustments and sharpening adjustments, it's harder to remove noise later. Now, you can, of course, come in and drag the noise filter to a different location or something. You could go back in and redo it. But right now, I like to add it right now. So I'm going to close the filters catalog down so you could see. I'm actually going to zoom in to the sky because that's where there's a lot of noise on this image. And I'm going to add just a little bit of color noise, and I think that's good for now. I probably have to come in and readjust this, though, so we'll leave that as it is now. Now I like to add contrast to the image. Remember, I didn't adjust the contrast slider at all. To add contrast, I like to use the curves filter. To do that, click on Add Filter, go to Professional, and Curves. And I'll just add the typical S curve. That will add contrast to the image. So I'm going to put a point right in the middle. Then I'm going to go down to the lower part of the diagonal line. This represents the shadows. I'm going to put a point there and pull that down. So I'm making the shadows a little darker. Then I'm going to go up to where the highlights are in the upper right-hand part of the diagonal line, put a point there and push up. And that makes those highlights a little brighter. And essentially, when you make the brighter parts brighter and the darker parts darker, you're adding contrast. There's before and there's after. Now you may be wondering, why do I prefer to use curves as opposed to the contrast slider? Well, the contrast slider is relatively uniform. You're going to add contrast throughout the entire image. With curves, I could be a little more selective. Let's say, for the sake of argument, that I would prefer to add more contrast in the highlights. Well, what I could do is add another point here, kind of straighten the curve in this part, in this mid-tone area, so I'm not adding contrast there. Then maybe add another point up in the brightest parts and push up, so I'm making the brighter parts, the brightest parts brighter, maybe these brighter parts a little brighter. So I could be a little more specific of where I'm adding the contrast with the curves filter. And again, it's just a preferable way for me to do it. I'm going to undo those last few steps, but that is pretty much how I would go about adding contrast to my image. Now, the next thing I like to do is do something with clarity. Now, I mentioned I don't often want to do too much with the clarity slider per se. I prefer to use either sharpening or to use some type of structure. Now, I prefer microstructure over regular structure. The reason being, in my opinion, the regular structure, which is up here in the Essentials section of the Filters catalog, could be a little bit heavy-handed. Meaning, if you move the amount slider, it looks like it's starting to be kind of linear, but then at one point, all of a sudden, it's just like too much. It's like very touchy. It's not as refined. It's like all or nothing in a way. So I prefer not to use structure. So I'm going to close that or get rid of that. And I'm going to add microstructure, which is under professional right there. And I think microstructure is a little bit more linear and a little bit less heavy-handed. So I could come in here and just add a little bit of this microstructure to my image. I think that looks pretty good. Next is debatable what I'll do. Now, I usually will do all of these. So I'll do the raw develop, denoise, curves, and microstructure, or maybe I just move the clarity slider, or maybe I'll do both at this point. The next thing I'll do is something more creative that I think my image needs. Now, when I was there this morning, it was about an hour after sunrise. And although it looks like the sun's in front of me, actually the sun was behind me. It was over my right shoulder. But the scene was very dramatic. As you can see, the sky's dramatic, but it was very warm in warm parts and very cool in cool parts. So I need to do something to try to make it look like it looked when I saw it. So I'm going to go to Add Filters, and I'm going to go to the Golden Hour. I like that filter. It's under Creative right there. So what we're going to do here is simple. I'm going to close down this filters catalog just so you could better see. I'm going to go to where it says Amount, and I'm simply going to move that to the right. And you can see how it just kind of warms up the warmer areas. And when you're warming up those warmer areas, it makes the cooler areas look that much cooler. It just, by default, kind of does that. So I kind of like that. Saturation, I could maybe enhance a little, just a tiny bit. I think that's fine. Now, when I've added these filters, I've noticed I'm starting to get a little bit more noise up here. So I'm going to move my luminance noise reduction more to the right, just to help get rid of that. Now, tell you the honest to God's truth, I'm pretty much consider it to be done. I do add a vignette almost always, so I'm going to do that. But that is why I really didn't want you to be too disappointed, because I don't do a ton. Now, there are some sensor spots, and I do those at the end, the very end. So let's do the vignette. And I guess maybe to better show, you know, so it doesn't look as confusing. Let's go to Add Filter. And vignette is at the top under Essentials. And I almost always use a dark vignette, and I always use a post-crop mode. So I will go to the amount, and to get a dark vignette, you'd go to the left. To get a light vignette, you'd go to the right. So I'm going to get that dark vignette. And what I'm going to do is bring it like very dark at the moment, the amount, so I could see it, so I could best see it. Then I'll affect the size a little bit, and then I'll kind of do roundness to try to get it to fit and feather a little bit. And then I'll come back to the amount, kind of pull it away a little bit. Then I'll kind of do a before after to see what I have here. There's before, there's after. Now, why I like the dark vignette, it helps pull everyone's gaze more towards the middle of the image, and the inner light will help with that as well. And I'll often add a little bit of an inner light, just to kind of brighten up that middle part a little bit. So there's a before, after, and I kind of like that. I think that's nice. Now, really, what I'll do at this point is I'll walk away, because sometimes your eyes get a little bit fatigued when you're doing these adjustments, and it will be overprocessed, and you don't realize it. So what I'll do is walk away for, you know, 15 minutes to half hour, come back and look at it. And if it's overprocessed, what I'll do is I'll go to this filters amount slider. This will affect the amount of adjustments we've done on all the filters. And I will pull that down, just to tone everything down a little bit. Now, what you have to remember here is when you're doing this, though, your denoise is going to get pulled down, too. So you may have to come back up here. If you pull the filters amount down, you may have to come back up here and increase your denoise. So just, you know, keep that in mind. And in this case, I didn't really walk away. My eyes are probably, you know, I probably overdone it is what I'm saying without realizing it. So I'll leave filters amount at 85. All right. So let's just, for the sake of argument, now I'll deal with these sensor spots. And I actually think they're water spots on my lens. There was no sensor spots to deal with, really. So what I'll do now is I'll go up to tools and I'll go to the erase tool. Now the erase tool is relatively slow. It takes a while to prepare, so it's going to prepare for several seconds, and when it does, we'll come back and actually apply the adjustment to those water spots. Okay, once the tool finally opens, I just go up to the tool attributes and make sure that we're on add, and that we're going to get the size brush that fits completely over the spot. In this case, I'm going to use the bracket keys to affect the size of the brush. The right bracket key makes it larger, the left bracket key smaller. I want the spot removal brush to be just a little bit bigger than the spot we're going to remove. So I'll click there. There's also a spot there. I think I need just a little bigger brush for that one. And there's a spot there. And that's just at a quick glance all I see. So I clicked all three of those. And then I'm going to click over here and click erase. And it will take a second to erase those three spots. Once it does, I'll just double check that it did a good job. And it did. It did a pretty good, oh, this one looks a little funky right here. That one too, actually. So I could come back in and redo it, but for the sake of this demonstration, I'm not going to do it. I'll just click done. And then we'll return to the normal workspace. Now, when we're back to the normal workspace, you'll notice that we have a new layer, the erased image layer. This is the layer that we use the eraser on. If I click on the layer below it, you'll notice that our sensor spots, or those water spots, will return. But we'll go back there. And that's it. That's all I really do. Let's do a before after. I'll click on the eyeball. There's before. And there's after. Before. After. Go to the side-by-side view, and there it is. There's before. After. So that's it. That's all I really do. Hopefully that helps you. You know, with your workflow, maybe you could incorporate a couple things I do into your workflow. And feel free in the comments section below, talk about what you like to do, which filters you prefer to use, and why you prefer to use them. Give us all different ideas of how we could go about using Luminar 3 to process our images. And thank you so much for watching my videos. I truly do appreciate it. I'll talk to you guys soon.